Hello everybody, and welcome to another lecture on computer architecture. Now I'm going to talk to you about structures and arrays, because they also don't exist in MIPS on the level of assembly and machine language. So let me again tell you what we did in the last lecture. We were doing in the memory access. We have seen, we looked at a Hello World program, and we've seen that actually to have access to the memory, everything at that moment is pointers. So to have access to it, we just use pointers. There are no variables. And today I will show you that there is also no such thing as data types. So there are no characters, there are no integers, there are no floats, there is nothing. There is only bit patterns. So let's do then a summary of what do we have actually at this moment. Well, we have arithmetic. That is the operation that we normally know from mathematics. So it looks as if we're doing integers. So this is integer operations. We have the memory access, as we've seen before, load word, store word, bytes, half words, and things like this. We have the logic operations, and with that I include shift left and shift right and things like this, and the conventional AND or an exclusive OR kind of operations. And we had the if then go to and simply go to operations. And with this if then go to and go to operations, we could actually implement the for loop and the while loop if we want, and even the repeat until loop. So this is the entire idea. Is we in this lecture we learn how to implement things from the higher level of programming like C or Pascal, how to implement this in a lower level like assembly or machine language. So we're going to continue this, and we're going to now to show that actually the data that we are working on is not even existent. Remember in one of the first lectures that I told you in the very first beginning that the data types, that actually the numbers or whatever it is that is in the computer, it doesn't exist. The only thing that exists is the bit patterns or the voltages, and actually how we interpret them, this is all the way up to us. And to give you an example, we did something very strange. I don't know if people noticed it, but we did something very strange in the previous, this I don't need yet, in the previous lecture. Namely, we were going to print Hello World, and then here we loaded, first we loaded the address of the string into a register, into T0, and then from there, once we knew the address of where the string was in memory, in the data segment, we actually then loaded a word into T1, then a half word into T2, and a byte into T3. And then we did something very strange. Now look at this, what we did in this instruction on line 14, add immediate to the target register T3, add to it 1, and then store it in T3. So what we did here actually was an integer operation. We added 1 to whatever is in T3. But in T3 was the first byte, namely the character H. So how can you add 1 to H? It doesn't make sense. Well, for the computer, for our assembly, it doesn't matter if it makes sense or not. It is of the type you wanted it, you got it. If you do something like this in C, which would be, if I would write here the equivalent of this, would be the character C equals, for instance, equals H, and then I would say, I don't want a capital, normally people use small letters, and then I say something like, maybe I would say something like C equals H plus 1. Well, I'm sure you agree that this doesn't, is not something you would do in C, because this is type mixing. H is a character, char if you want, some people call it char, and this is an integer. You cannot add an integer type to a character type. That doesn't make sense, but in assembly it makes perfect sense. It just means that actually the ASCII code, which H was number, what was it, 66 if I'm not mistaken? No, 68, well, whatever, it doesn't matter so much. It's 68 or 69, whatever, and we're just adding a number 1 to it, so it becomes 70 or 71 or something like this. And then it becomes a different, of course, by convention, by convention, it becomes a different character. And everything is by convention. The only thing this thing is doing, it's taking the bit pattern and interpreting it in this statement, because it's arithmetic. It's interpreting it as an integer and then adding one to it. No problem, you can do this. And then we can print it again as if it were a character, which we're doing then printing this hello world. Once again, to show you what this program actually is doing, it is then first printing hello world, that is done here. And then it is adding one to the character h, storing it back into, with store byte, storing it back into memory, and then again printing the text that is in memory, but it has now changed into yellow world. Not doesn't make much sense, but that is what you wanted, so that is what you get. In this case, you can see that the thing has a type, a variable. Variables don't exist, and types don't exist. So the thing is that once you use the message I had, once you use with load word, store word, and things like this, everything is pointers. The data that is in the registers, that was one moment is a character, the other moment is an integer. At the moment when you do load word, whatever is in the register is interpreted as a pointer. So it is a bit pattern that then points to an address in memory. So now we get this next new problem that also things like structures and arrays, they do not exist, because the only thing we have is actually is pointers. So Houston, we got a problem. And then how is this solved? Well, the compiler actually is will have to keep track of where the things are in memory. So imagine I define here, I will put it a little bit to the left here. Imagine that I define here in C a structure that has these four fields. It has a 256 character name string. Then it has an integer age, a character, the gender of the person, and a character again, a string, a city of 256 bytes. So it will then, the compiler knows, well, how much memory does this take? Well, 256 bytes, it's 64 words. Let's also put this one word, let's do data alignment instead of this, this is still okay, one word is 4 bytes, because that's an int in our MIPS. But then we have a character that is actually a quarter of a word, because it's only 8 bits, but let's also just store it as a word, because we want to do data alignment, which will be discussed in another lecture. And finally, we have 256 bytes for the city, that is 64 words, so in the total it has 130 words. So the compiler then, what it is doing, it remembers the pointer to the start of the structure, and then whenever it is needed, for instance, the gender, it is calculating this, where is that information. So it's taking the pointer structure and then adding, what is it, 260 bytes to it. So the address is the structure name plus 260. So the compiler actually is taking a track of this, meaning that at runtime this thing is going to be calculated. And if you're in programming in assembly, you have to do this calculation. Not so nice. Now you understand why higher level programming languages were invented, to not having to do these things all the time. But now we are learning how to do assembly, so we have to do this. So I'll give here an example. I have it here already, structure assembly. So here we have this structure that I just defined. And then what are we going to do? First, we're going to ask the user for to give a name. How did we do this? Let me see if I still have this here. MIPS system calls. We first have to print a string address that is system call number 4, and we have to supply in A0 the address of null terminated string, and that will be name prompt will be this one. So name prompt, the address of this will be put into A0, and then we do a system call. The operating system will then ask for a string, and this is then actually going to be used in the rest. Namely, what we're going to do then is to calculate the address of the structure, the structure name. That points, let me show this again here if I have this here, that points actually to the start of the structure, which actually is then also the start of the name. So we supply here we supply in A0, we supply the address of that structure name and then do a system call 8. What is system call 8? That is read string. And we have to supply the address of the where we want to place the string that is going to be read. And then also 8, A1 is the maximum length. Well, I put there 256. And then the operating system is reading a string and placing it in the address that we supplied. And that is namely structure name. That is still very simple. But now we want to ask for the age. So once again, what we're going to do, we're going to print the string, this one, age prompt, age. We're going to print with the system call 4. We're going to print that text age on the screen. And then we do system call 5, which is read integer. And we then the result will be that it will be placed into V0. Okay, we place this. We do a system call 5, and then we have to copy this, that is now in V0, we have to copy this into this address, and that is structure name plus 256. So we have to do the calculation, and this is done here, as you can see, add 256 to the address A0 that contained actually, oh, I think this is actually mistake, but that would contain then our it's okay. If we first again load the structure name and then we add 256 to it, which then points to our age field inside the structure, and then we store the word that was in V0, that is the age. We will store it where, namely in the address pointed to by A0, and so on. I hope you get the idea. Every time we want to address, we want to address a field, we have to do the calculation where exactly is this thing in memory. We don't have this thing as, and then to use remember from C, you put a dot and then specify the field, because there is no such thing as a field. It doesn't exist. There are no variables. There are no structures. There is nothing. The only thing you have is a pointer, and you have to do the calculation where in memory resides the information. Now, this one I hope you get. The next one is actually even a little bit more complicated, because now we're going to, so here's the program that I just showed you. Now we're going to do arrays. And arrays are, as you remember, arrays are structures where all the data fields are of the same type. And they have actually important differences also, that they can be multidimensional. And imagine that you have here a 2x2 matrix from your mathematics, and you have to somehow do the mapping to a one-dimensional array that is our memory. So this is more like the memory itself, the physical memory is a vector. So how do you do the mapping from a two-dimensional array? You map it to a one-dimensional vector in memory. Well, once again, you have to do the calculation where the thing resides in memory. So imagine we have this 3x3 matrix that goes with elements from A00, A01, A02, all the way to A22. So if you map this into memory, this is how they are placed. First A00, then A01, then A02, then A10, then A11, and then A12. So it's placing this one first, then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one. Maybe you don't see where I'm at. Here, then this one, and then this one. You can actually also, it depends on you as the assembler writer or the compiler writer, you can also place them first this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, and then this one, etc. It doesn't matter. But normally it is done like this, that we place them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so forth. So this two-dimensional array is mapped into a one-dimensional vector in memory. So we have to do the calculation. So to cut everything short, the address where the element ij is in memory is the base address of your array, the array pointer, plus, and then you have to do calculate 4 times, because one element, in this case, is an integer. So an integer takes 4 bytes. So this is the size of an element, that's 4, times 3, which is numbered elements in one row. That's why it's 3, times I, that is the row number. And then plus 4 times, once again, the size of an individual element, times j, which is the column index. And this is then the final address of where the thing is residing in memory. So imagine we want to do address this a to 0. That would be, and the base address is 0, for instance. That would be 4 times 3 times 2. So that is 12, that's 24. Plus 4 times, what did I say? 20, wasn't it? So that is 20, that would be 24. That would be a base address plus 24 would be the final address where this element 20 would be in memory. So now your exercise would be, imagine that I give you this set of coordinates, x, y, z, so that is 10 coordinates. They will be placed like this in memory. You can declare them in, I will put it already here. I only wanted to show you this first part. So this is how you store this in memory. You just define an array, which is point word, and then declare all the values. And I want you to find out which of these coordinates has the smallest sum. So for instance, this, the sum of this one is 0 plus 1 plus 2, that is 3. And here we have 7 plus 1 minus 1, that is 7, and so on. I want you to find out, to write a program to find out which of these coordinates has the lowest sum of x, y, and z. Do you think you can do this? Well, I will give you the answer in another lecture, or actually online somewhere. So good luck, and see you in the next lecture.